I want to just let you know a couple things right up front. First of all, I'll do all that sappy stuff, you know, it was great to be here and all that. We'll do that tomorrow morning, because we've got a packed group tonight, and I'm of two minds right now. I'm simultaneously nervous, not nervous in the sense that I'm hoping I do a good job. No, not that. But nervous in the sense that I want the passion and burden on my heart tonight to be clear. And I'm just praying, God, you know me, you know my weaknesses, my frailties, my foibles, so work through and in spite of all of that and make it really clear. That's the first mind I'm of. And the second mind is that I am just so enthusiastic about what I'm going to share tonight, but I need you to give me permission. To give me what? Permission. Okay, and here's what we're going to do. We're not going to have a Q&A tonight, not because they're not awesome. I think Rodley and Dwight have done a great job, and Kyle did a great job in the chapel, but because the plate tonight, what we're going to be talking about in many ways today and tomorrow are the climax of the whole thing that we've been talking about. This is the point, right? We've been building very carefully, I think very intentionally and very soundly, but tonight we have a full plate. I mean, it's a big meal tonight. And so in the same way that on the third night I asked you to give me permission to speak to you like you were a university congregation. Do you remember that? I said, I need you to be in the zone. This is going to be, require some thinking, require some attentiveness. The same is very true of tonight. And so it's going to be somewhat thick. It's going to require that you follow the line, but I believe that if you can just trust me as we do this and this and this, and we'll have all of these seeming threads kind of out and about, at the end of it all, we'll tie it up. And so I need you to be with me. Can you be in the zone tonight for the next about 50 minutes? Can you do that? Great. And I also want to let you know, we will be making an appeal tonight. And I like to let people know right up front that we're making an appeal, so it's not, you know, the preacher trying to spring an emotional trap on you or to lure you into doing something that you wouldn't otherwise do. I want you to know that this is headed toward a decision. It's headed toward an appeal. And we'll tell you more about that as the message comes to a close. So I'm just going to have a quick prayer, and then we are going to be getting right into the thick of the story. So let's pray together. Father in heaven, I want to thank you for the kindness that Kevin and Jonathan have shown here on behalf of the Andrews University students and staff and faculty. It has been a delight to be here. Father, you know, I've been looking forward to this appointment for months, and it has exceeded even my high expectations. Father, I have loved and felt loved, and in all of this, we have felt your love. Father, we've been asking the question all week, this is my church, in the interrogative. And as we're building and putting point on point and block on block, it's coming clearer to me, and I believe to many, that this is my church, and this is a beautiful message. And tonight, and especially tomorrow, these two, as we tie this up, I just pray that it would be completely and totally to your glory. At the end of this thing, I'm just really hopeful, Father, that people won't say, oh, he was a good presenter, or that was nice, or the program was well done, or even the music was good. All of those things may well be true. But Father, at the end, may we say, I understand my faith, and I understand and know Jesus better. Father, give us that sense, that resolve, that our life has eternal consequence, not mere temporal consequence. Father, tonight's a big one. It's a pivotal one. And so I'm asking for your Spirit to do what a human being could never do. Come into this place and into these hearts and work your work. In Jesus' name, let everyone say, amen. Amen. All right, here we go. You tell me. This is the table of truth, and we have been building. And we have discussed the fact that Scripture can be sort of summarized in three simple words. And those words are, if you remember them, say them with me. They are creation, conflict, and covenant. We've talked a little bit about creation. In fact, for those of you that are paying attention, you might be saying, well, where are the other doctrines? Where are the other things that are making their way onto the table? Well, creation has now made its way onto the table. Right? As a doctrine, as something to believe, creation has made its way onto the table, not merely as a checklist item, but as something that is, again, not merely compatible with, but complementary of this beautiful picture of who God is. As we continue today and especially tomorrow, we're going to find that other elements, other biblical doctrinal elements are going to be really subtly, almost unawares, making their way onto the table. And that's the way it should be. We don't come to Scripture looking for something, looking for an agenda, looking for a doctrinal package. We come saying, God, teach us who you are and what you are. And as we put the character of God front and center, these other truths, as we continue to study Scripture, they just make their way onto the table in a really awesome way, in a supportive way, and in a compatible and in a complementary way. Last night we talked about conflict, and so the great controversy motif, that whole picture of God at war and God in conflict, has also made its way onto the table. And today we're going to talk about covenant, but covenant itself is set against the backdrop of both creation and conflict. In many ways, these things form almost a triad of a systematic understanding of the Bible. Creation leads to conflict, which leads to covenant, and each one of them is equally dependent on the other in the same way that a triangle gains its structure from creating a plane. Right? A tripod, we talked about. A plane is now created, and as we affirm creation and conflict and covenant, the whole thing starts to come. Many of us would be clear, probably, on the idea of creation. We get that. God created in the beginning. God created the heavens and the earth. We get that. And many of us would be really probably comfortable with the idea that there's some sort of a conflict going on here. The world appears to be at war. One of my favorite theologians, a man by the name of Greg Boyd, I love the way he says it. He says, the reason the world looks like a war zone is because it is a war zone. Right? And so even just experientially, if you had nothing, if you knew nothing of Scripture, no biblical context, if all you had was CNN and Fox News and BBC, you could walk away very safely experientially and say, the world is a war zone. But each one of us in this room, we also know that there's not just a war zone externally, there's a war zone internally, isn't there? We find ourselves warring against ourselves. We find that we are at times our own worst enemies, and so we are born into a conflicted situation, both in the external world with the politics and the governments and the militaries and the terrorists, but also internally. We are conflicted. There is something we long to be, but we find it very difficult and impossible to be the thing we want to be. We yearn for something more and greater, and yet we find ourselves incapable of achieving it. And so we are, as it were, trapped in a morass of conflict. And most of us would be clear on that. Maybe not every theological detail, but in general, we get the concept. Covenant, though, is a tricky one. What is that? What does that mean? And that's what we're going to try and unpack tonight. We've already discussed the idea that God is not a rigid singularity, right? Just alone, by himself, even lonely. But that Scripture reveals that God is a plurality, a family, a covenantal reality. That as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, this God is not merely loving in his behaviors or in his actions. Scripture says this God, well, it's actually our first thing that's on the table. Scripture says that this God is what? Love. And that makes really good sense if, in fact, God is a plurality, if there is a relational, covenantal substance to reality, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and one of the students quoted it on the video there, that creation didn't somehow make God loving by giving him the opportunity to do that. No, God's love made creation. And it's in that context that God is himself a covenant, that we encounter in Scripture that God makes a series of covenants with humanity, and that's to be expected. I mentioned that last night when I first heard this basic idea. The person that got my mind thinking about this was a longtime pastor of this very church, Pastor Skip McCarty. And when I picked up his book, Ingrained or Ingrained, I was really looking forward to just getting some ammo to use against people who didn't see the law and the Sabbath my way. But what Pastor McCarty does when he opens up that book is he basically says the reason that God relates on the basis of covenant to Adam and to Noah and to Abraham is that God himself is covenantal. Beautiful, beautiful picture. Now, with that in mind, I want to try and paint a picture of what I am very persuaded the whole issue of covenant is. Let me give an illustration. My family and I just recently, we made our first trip to Washington, D.C. and New York City. We'd been there before, but we hadn't really had a chance to go and see the city and to spend time there. We spent several days in Washington, D.C., especially in and around the mall, and we spent some time in the various Smithsonian museums. One of the Smithsonian museums that we went into was the Museum of Natural History, and one of the things that I most wanted to see was the famed Hope Diamond. And I remember when we first walked in there, there was just this, you know, it just casts this beautiful sort of prismatic light all around the room, and they've got it in this little case, you know, and it's this huge diamond. I mean, it's the size, I suppose, almost of a baseball. As it's turning and you look into it, you see so many facets, so many hues, so many colors, so many dimensions. There are prisms within prisms and dimensions within dimensions and hues within hues, and the gospel story is just like that. There are so many ways to tell the gospel story. There are so many avenues that you can take. You can come from this direction, you can come from this direction, you can come from this direction. And what often happens to us is we hear one version of the gospel story and we think that's the gospel story. Well, in fact, it is. But if you move to this side of the Hope Diamond, there's yet another prism within a prism, a dimension within a dimension, and this multidimensionality of the gospel, this multidimensionality of the love of God is something that's really awesome. Because some of us are visual people, and some of us are, we love to read, and others of us just are social, or whatever it might be. And the Bible has its tentacles in all of these different and individual ways so that we can each in our own way feel and embrace the good news. I want to share with you tonight what speaks to me, where I'm at. And I hope and I believe it's going to deeply resonate with you. Last night in the question and answer period, a question came up in which I was given the opportunity to say to Rodley that without question, the most hotly debated and disputed passage in all of Scripture is Genesis chapters 1 to 11. That's the passage. It is the passage around which you are either, you know, a theological liberal or a theological conservative. You take either a high view of Scripture or a low view of Scripture. Is Genesis chapters 1 to 11 merely allegorical, mythical, or whatever it might be? Is it a grand poem, or is it history? And how you answer that question, I believe, becomes determinative for how you view the rest of Scripture. Now, what I want to do is talk a little bit about what's happening in Genesis 1 to 11. We've already talked about chapters 1 and 2, in which God creates. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And last night, we spent some time in Genesis 3, in which conflict is entered into the picture. And not just any ordinary conflict, but a conflict that comes from the enemy himself, who begins to raise significant questions about what's behind the wall. What kind of a being are we dealing with here? And that tripod of temptation that we talked about, this idea that God is not trustworthy and that God is looking out for his own best interests and that God is restrictive and prohibitive. And these raised serious questions in the universe, and this whole conflict motif, this controversy motif, is who is God? What kind of a being is he? What kind of a person is he? And Genesis chapter 3 then launches into 4, 5, 6, 7, and Moses, who's sitting and writing, I see Moses writing furiously, and he's racing through about 2,000, in round numbers, years of Earth's history. I mean, he just goes flying through it. Genesis 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 covers, you know, in round figures, about 2,000 years of Earth's history, and he races through it, and he really only gives us about three major events. He says creation took place, the flood took place, and the Tower of Babel took place. I mean, that's it. It's just like the highest of the mountains, the highest of the mountain, the highest of the mountain, and shoo, we arrive at Genesis 12. And then he slows way down, right? Because the rest of Genesis from chapter 12 to chapter 50 is about 200 years of human history. Now just let that sink in. In the first 11 chapters, you move through, you know, thousands of years, and then in the last 39 chapters, you move through about 200 years. Why? Because he's racing to get to the point. He is just telling, in just the broadest strokes, the history of humanity, the history of Earth, because he's trying to get to the story of Abraham. He's trying to get to the story of Abraham. Now, up to this point, God has already begun to relate on the basis of covenant. God made a covenant with Adam. And the nature of that covenant was, in the day that you eat of that tree, you will surely die. He didn't say, I will kill you. He said, you'll die. Adam broke covenant with God, and we talked about that last night. The family of God and the family of man were severed over the issue of distrust, and that's the nature of the controversy. Is God trustworthy? Is God believable? Is God someone even worth obeying? And when that distrust came not only into the Garden of Eden, but into the universe at large, you have this major breaking between the family of God and the family of humanity, and this will become hugely significant for us tonight. What was created as a beautiful bond and love and connection is now severed. How will this be put back together? And God seeks to do so through covenant. God makes a covenant with a man named Noah, and time does not allow me to go through and show how in many ways what God was doing with Noah was starting creation over. It was his new man and his new covenant and a new opportunity and a new situation. But just as Adam had fallen short of the covenant arrangement, fallen short of the agreement, so too had Noah. And then Moses, he's racing to get through the story, and we just have to pause here briefly at Genesis 11. Let me remind you of the story of Babel because it's an important one. In Genesis chapter 11, it sort of tells this story that at that time on earth, a bunch of people, perhaps most of humanity, got together and they said, we want to make a name for ourselves. We want to make a name for who, everyone? Ourselves. And God comes down and he basically says, man, look at the unity here. Look at the collaboration here. If they continue along these lines, they'll be able to do anything. And my plan of bringing humanity back to me will be forever thwarted. And so God comes down and in an act of not so much punitive as strategic, God comes down and he disperses them by mixing up their languages. And the languages are now, the people are now dispersed. And you get this idea that what ends up happening is all of these different identities, national identities and religious identities, cultural identities, linguistic identities, so that there's people on this side of the mountain and people on that side of the mountain. We're us and they're them. There's people on this side of the river and people on that side of the river. We're us and they're them. There's people on this side of the ocean and on that side of the ocean. We're us and they're them. And so as Moses brings Genesis 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 to a close, humanity is facing two major problems, and he has raced through 2,000 years of human history. Now, how many problems did I say they were facing? Two. And the first problem is the problem of Genesis 3. Humanity is cut off from God. That's this problem right here. But the second problem is the problem of Genesis 11. Humanity is now cut off from one another. There's them and us, and black and white, and male and female, and that group and this group. And so as the call of Abraham comes in Genesis chapter 12, humanity is cut off from God and fragmented and cut off from themselves up into these little divisions, these little groups. By the way, just a very interesting little fast forward in the story. When the Holy Spirit finally falls on the day of Pentecost, many, many, many years yet in the future, what ends up happening is a marvelous thing. As the gift of tongues comes upon Israel, we'll talk about that here in just a minute, upon the disciples, they begin to speak with other languages, and watch what happens now. The nations are coming back together. God is reversing the curse of Genesis 11. So we got two problems here. We're cut off from God and we're cut off from one another, and the covenant restores both. I want to show you how. In Genesis chapter 12, God appears to Abram. Moses raced to get here, and now he's getting into the real thick of the story. And with that in mind, I want to show you a statement here on the screen. This is from Paul in Galatians chapter 3, verse 29. Now, this is fast forwarding ahead, but just to give you a feel. Look at what he says. He says, and if you are who? Christ's, then you are who? Abraham's seed or offspring and heirs according to the promise. Now, all I want you to get at this point, don't worry about the seed and the promise and all that. At this point, I just want you to see this basic idea that for Paul, the deal or the covenant that God made with Abraham was normative. It is the thing that God is going to use to bring restoration to the world. I said it last night, I'll say it again. The call of Abraham is God's answer to the sin of Adam. Do you get that? Let's see if we can say that together. The call of Abraham is God's answer to the sin of Adam. Let's try it. The call of Abraham is God's answer to the sin of Adam. right? Adam and Eve had forfeited the land. They had forfeited the garden. And one of the centerpieces of the promise that God makes to Abraham is, you'll get the land back. You'll get the land back. They have been severed from one another. They have been severed from God. And he says, and you'll have descendants. And all the families of the earth will be blessed in you. Now, Ellen White was walking right hand in hand with Paul. Notice this statement from her, just exactly the very same kind of idea. We're just fast-forwarding here so we can understand where we're going. We're coming back in a moment. The terms of this, what is that word there? The terms of this oneness between God and man, that's the family of God and the family of man, in the great covenant of redemption were arranged with Christ from all eternity. The covenant of grace was revealed to the patriarchs. The covenant made with who? Abraham, notice the next slide, was a covenant confirmed by God in Christ. It's the very same gospel that's preached to us today. So for Paul and for Ellen White, and if time allowed, we could show for Jesus and for all of the New Testament writers, what God was doing in Abraham was pivotal for the whole world. This was not merely a Jewish thing. This was a human thing. God had made a covenant with Adam, which had failed. He made a covenant with Noah, which had failed in part. And now he makes a covenant with Abraham. And the nature of the covenant that God makes with Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, it says, now the Lord had said to Abraham, come out of your country, from your family, from your father's house, to a land that I will show you. And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you. And I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. This is a reversal both of the problems of Genesis 3, the severing from God, and the severing from one another. I will bring unity and connectivity through you, Abraham. And Abraham, he hears the breadth and the bigness and the broadness of these promises, and he thinks, man, these are huge promises. What could I possibly do to fulfill these promises? And this is where Scripture gives the most, Abraham just basically hits the nail on the head. It gives him this grand compliment. It says that he believed God. He believed it. God shows up and says, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this, and I will do this, and then I will do this, and I will do this. And Abraham's like, that sounds awesome. I believe you. And then now we're off to the races. The rest of Scripture is set against the backdrop of what God is doing through Abraham. Now, that doesn't mean that there weren't little hiccups. There were a couple little hiccups. For example, Abraham at this point doesn't have a son, right? And so when God originally appears to him and says that you'll have a son, a number of years goes by, and Sarah is not, she's not had a child, and I think it's 7 years, I don't remember exactly. And so when the promised child does not come, Abraham and Sarah cook up a bit of a plan. And the plan is that Abraham will take Hagar. Now, that was in keeping with ancient Near Eastern tradition, so it was fine, but it wasn't God's promise. Now, here's where something gets really interesting. This is in Genesis 15, 16, and 17. And God then appears after the birth of the child, Ishmael. God appears back to Abraham and says, Abraham, I'm going to make a covenant with you. You're going to have a promised child, and in you all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And Abraham has the temerity to say, oh, God, thank you. Let Ishmael live before you. And God says, no, 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 no. Now, he's your son, and I'll bless him accordingly. But he's not the promised son because he came from Hagar, not from Sarah. I told you Sarah would have a child. That's Genesis 15. Now, here's Genesis 16, and I don't want to be indelicate, but I'm going to tell you what the Bible says. What Abraham had sought to do was to try and solve the problem. I mean, at first he said, I believe you, God, and it was not without a hiccup or a stumble. But here, when God seems to be slow or not punctual in coming through with his promises, he says, I will with my own strength and with my own masculinity. We together? I'll do this. And God says, okay, Abraham, let me teach you a lesson. It's going to be a lesson for you and for all of your descendants. We're going to cut the tip of that thing off. Are you smelling what I'm cooking here? Now, don't miss this because, I mean, otherwise, what is the meaning of circumcision? I mean, that's kind of weird. It's really arbitrary. It's really strange. I mean, is God just like, what can we cut off? Right? No. The reason was God was sending a message, and it was a message that was built around the fact that when the covenant had begun, when it had first begun, Abraham had simply believed that God would do what he said he would do. Abraham what? But now he sets out to do for God what God promised that he would do for Abraham. Now hold on to this. The good news, the gospel, and the covenant has never been about Abraham's promises to God, but God's promises to Abraham. Now let's modernize that. The gospel, the good news, has never been about your promises to God. It's always been about God's promises to you. So God says, we'll give you a symbol, snip, snip, we'll cut the tip of that thing off, and it will be an ongoing symbol of righteousness by believing my promises. Now, in one of the strangest ironies in all of Scripture, by the time we come down to Jesus' day, right, that symbol of righteousness by believing and trusting God had actually become a legalistic thing, a sign of patriotism and of national identity and even of righteousness. Can you imagine that something like, say something like the Sabbath, which is a gift and a sign of God's creational and redemptive power, can you imagine that that could ever become a sign of legalism and of our own righteousness? Impossible, right? So, God makes this covenant with Abraham, but in the midst of it, I've got to share this with you. This is hugely significant. When he does so, I want to read it to you. Genesis 15, and it says in verse 6, and Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Then he said, I am the Lord who brought you out of the Ur of the Chaldees to give you this land. And then Abraham asked the legitimate question, how will I know that I will inherit it? And he said, bring me three things, a three-year-old heifer, a three-year-old female goat, a three-year-old ram, and a turtle dove and a pigeon. So three animals and some birds, bring those to me. So Abraham says, how do I know you're going to do this? He says, go bring some animals. Now watch what happens. This is interesting. We may come back to this, and if we do, it'll be huge. It says in verse 10, then he brought all of these, and he cut them in two down the middle, and he placed each piece opposite the other, but he did not cut the birds in two. And when the vultures came on the carcasses, Abraham drove them away. So Abraham basically says, how do I know that you're going to keep this promise? How do I know that you're going to do what you say you're going to do? And he says, go get me three animals, cut them in two, and make a pathway between them. Make a what? A pathway. And don't cut the birds. Now, in the midst of this here, and I should probably just comment here, that Abraham would have understood what God was saying, and it went something like this. They are now entering into an agreement, into a covenant, and this sacrifice is ratifying or sealing the covenant, and it goes something like this. It's basically saying, if I am not faithful to the covenant, may what's happened to these animals, this bifurcating, this splitting, this cutting, may that happen to me. I am binding myself to this covenant. I will be faithful to the covenant, and the other party, God says, and I will be faithful to the covenant, and both are saying, and if either of us breaks the terms of the covenant, then we will be cut down the middle, right? Now, Abraham then falls asleep, and then the Bible has this really weird verse, and it's just straight up weird. Verse 12, it says, now when the sun was going down, right? He's just cut the pathway between the animals. It says, as the sun was going down, Abraham gets tired, and it says, a deep sleep fell on Abram, and behold, a horror and great darkness fell upon him. He has a nightmare, a terrible nightmare. Now, he wakes up in the middle of this nightmare, and listen to verse 17, and it came to pass, when the sun went down and it was dark, that behold, there appeared a smoking oven, and a burning torch passing between the cut pieces. A smoking oven and a burning torch. What is this? Let's review. God says, I'm going to make a promise to you, Abraham, and I will keep it. Abraham says, how do I know you'll keep it? Bring me some animals, cut them in two, make a path. So he does. Abraham understood. He's saying, I'm binding myself by my own life to this covenant. And then God says, I am binding myself by my own life to this covenant. And if either of us violates, may we be split, just as these animals are split. Then Abraham goes to sleep. He wakes up groggily in the middle of this nightmare, and he sees a burning torch and a smoking oven brooding over the split pieces, walking back and forth between the split pieces, and that's it, nothing more. That's it. It's just left to sort of hang there. Now, we're going to hold on to that, and we're going to hopefully come back to that idea. Up to this point, we basically have Abraham. Abraham believes the promises of God. Abraham's descendants now inherit this covenant promise. Abraham, he's not just the God of Abraham. He becomes the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God is trying to bring healing and restoration back to the family of God and the family of man, and he's doing it through Abraham. Abraham was largely faithful, which is why he becomes the archetypal covenant keeper, the one who believed. But the descendants of Abraham do not fare quite so well. And the history of much of the Old Testament, which I won't take time to explore here tonight, is an uninterrupted succession of breaking the covenant, breaking the covenant, breaking the covenant, breaking the covenant, breaking the covenant. Now, at this point, somebody might say, well, what's the covenant all about? What's the terms of the covenant? And we can summarize it in a single word, actually. The word is love. The covenant is built around love. And if you want to further explicate that, Jesus said, well, it's like this. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And if you want to further explicate it, you could say, well, the first, second, third, and fourth commandments is how you love God. And the fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, and tenth commandments is how you love humanity. And we could further explicate it still. But when you rewind the tape backward, the covenant is built around a supreme love for God and an authentic love for humanity. That the terms of that covenant, love, were then placed in a box, a very special box, a box that became holy by virtue of the terms of the covenant that were placed within it. And then it was placed not just in the box, but in the innermost sanctum of the most holy place in all of Israel's economy and architecture. The most holy place. What's in there? God's in there. God is in that place, and it's the Ark of the Covenant. And inside of the Ark of the Covenant is the terms of the covenant. God has extended his hand to Abram, and Abram has believed the promises of God. But the rest of the Old Testament is largely, and I don't want to oversimplify, but for time I've got to simplify. The rest of the Old Testament is largely a story of a violation of the covenant, a violation, a violation, a violation, a violation, a violation. So much so that God finally gets to the place where he can no longer protect, he can no longer keep, he can no longer surround his chosen people, the descendants of Abraham, and he has to give them up to their own decisions and choices. I run a school called Arise, and over the years, we've never kicked anyone out. We've had over 600 students. We've never kicked anybody out. But we have honored some students' decisions to leave. You hear the difference? We sit down with somebody and they'll say, "Hey, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to do that. I'm really sorry. Are you kicking me out?" "No." "Oh." "But we are going to honor your decision to leave." what do you mean? "I want to stay." We hear your mouth. We hear that. We got you. But we've been over this one, two, three. We're really graceful over there. One, two, three, four times, and your actions are speaking louder than your words, and so we're going to honor your choice. That's how much we love you. We're going to honor your choice. God said the same thing essentially with Israel. He said, "Hey, look, man, I honor your choice. You want to live like that? I honor your choice. It's painful to me. It's hard for me, and there's going to be terrible armies that are going to come from the north, but I will let you have what you think you want." And we fast forward to this prophet named Daniel, who is a pivotally important prophet for those of us in the Advent community. And in Daniel chapter 9, we have a prophet Daniel. I mean, the kingdom is shattered. The descendants of Abraham are here, there, and everywhere in between. And Daniel is on his knees, and he's crying out in a prayer to God. And I want you to hear just the first thing that he says, just the first thing that he says. Here's this prayer. It's in Daniel chapter 9, and he just opens his heart in one of the most emotionally pregnant and powerful prayers in all of Scripture. Listen to this. He's in Babylon. Judah, Israel, dispersion, captivity. It's a disaster. And I want you to hear the burning burden of Daniel's heart. What's on the tip of his tongue? "And I prayed to the Lord my God, and I made confession, and I said, O Lord, great and awesome God," that's the first thing, that's just the introduction so we know who we're talking to, "who keeps his covenant." first thing out of his mouth, who keeps his covenant and mercy with those who love him and with those who keep his commandments. Now watch this. We have sinned and committed iniquity. We have done wickedly and rebelled, even by departing from your precepts and your judgments. Neither have we heeded your servants, the prophets who spoke in your name to our kings and our princes, to our fathers and all the people of the land. Notice what he's saying. We have not abided by the terms of the covenant. But the first thing out of his mouth is, you have kept covenant with us. You have been faithful. You have been righteous. But we have fallen. We have failed. And we have fumbled. Now, at the end of Daniel chapter 9, a really cool thing happens. There's this promise of a Messiah. A Messiah who would come. And the Bible says that Messiah would keep covenant with God. The Messiah would do what Adam had failed to do and what Noah had failed to do. And even Abraham, though he got off to a right start, he ultimately failed to do. And all of the descendants of Abraham down through the ages have failed. And here's this little glimmer of a promise that Messiah will come. A Messiah will come and he will keep covenant. Daniel actually calls him the Prince of the Covenant. Now, I want you to get a visual here. God has extended his hand to Adam, and that hand was let go. God extends his hand to Noah, and that hand was initially held and then let go. He extends his hand to Abraham, and Abraham got it the most, which is why he becomes the archetypal covenant keeper. And Abraham clings, and God says, that's right. You believe me. You hang on to that. You hang on to that belief. You hang on to that trust. But then the descendants of Abraham cling, let go, cling, let go, cling, let go. And then they got to the place where they could have cared less about the extended hand, right? So who will keep covenant? I mean, is the thing just to left, is it just to be left dangling out there like some fishing line, never to be, I mean, is that it? Is it just over? Is that the end of the story? And it's as if God essentially says, if this covenant is ever going to be kept, I'm going to have to keep it myself. Now somebody says, but he's already keeping covenant as God. You're right. But how will the family of God and the family of humanity be reconnected? How's that going to happen? Oh! And here is where the grandest plot twist in all of literature, the grandest plot twist that could ever be imagined takes place. Remember, Lucifer had said that he'd seen behind that curtain. Ooh, and he was concerned about what was back there. I mean, after all, God is God, and he's big, and he's scary, and he's powerful, and he rules with a rod of iron. And yet, here comes God. He does the unthinkable. He does the incommunicable. He does the mysterious and the enigmatic. He comes from behind. He steps out in some significant sense of his godness. And this is where the theologians, our language is just blah, 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 blah. It's just like little babies cooing. We say he divested himself. And God, the immutable, eternal, incommunicable, ineffable, spirit God of the universe, he's in a manger. And I can just imagine that Satan, with all of his objections and all of his insinuations, was thinking, what's he doing there? What's going on in the manger? God has come from behind the godness, and he has somehow miraculously divested himself of those attributes of godness. He didn't leave behind the fact that he was God, but those characteristics that would have not made him able to be a human being, he somehow left them there, and he's in a manger. And I can imagine not just Lucifer himself, who was absolutely incredulous about this new development. The angels, both loyal and disloyal, are equally puzzled. What is going on here? This is quite the surprise, right? And this baby, this child grows, and the punchline of the story is that as he grows, he never doesn't keep covenant with God. He just does this absolutely amazing thing where at every step of the way, he loves the Lord as God with all his heart, mind, and soul, as a 2-year-old, as a 4-year-old, as a 6-year-old, 16-year-old, 25-year-old, right through. And he loves humanity openly and honestly and transparently and sincerely and vulnerably. And temptation after temptation comes, and if time allowed, we could go and look at the nature of those temptations. But here is someone who is a man who's keeping covenant with God. And all of the hellish and satanic forces that could be levied at him are thrown at him and leveraged upon him, thrown at this being. Now, it's right at this point. And by the way, of course, the climax of that finds itself in Gethsemane. We find ourselves at the cross. That's where the whole thing, I mean, it just pushing and pushing because he's been faithful, 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 faithful. He has kept covenant with God. He has loved the Lord his God with all his heart, mind, and soul. And the second is like it. He's loved his neighbor as himself. And Satan is getting increasingly anxious. And this is not so easy as we thought it would be. And so he concocts various and sundry schemes. And most of the New Testament is Jesus being tempted in various and sundry ways by different, you know, individuals from various parties. And Jesus is just navigating somehow, amazingly, navigating through the minefield, not aligning himself with the Pharisaical or the Sadduceical or the Essenic traditions. He's something new. He's something for, who is this guy? What's going on here? And there had always been a hope. As Daniel had prayed there, and he knew that the history of his own people had been one in which there had been failure after failure after failure to keep covenant. There was always a hope that someone would keep covenant. And there's this promise, this glittering promise, the Messiah will keep covenant. Now, it's right at this point. We're going to press pause, and we're going to come back to the Garden of Gethsemane. But I need you to go with me to a really weird place. We're going to go first to a normal place, and we're going to go to a weird place in Scripture, seemingly weird. Psalm 40. If you've got your Bibles, listen to this. Psalm 40. This is one of those promises. The Jewish people, they were not all unfaithful, of course not. There were instances of revival individually and even at times corporately. But the Jewish people, they would cling to these promises of the coming Messiah, and yet, of course, they began to get a perverse understanding of just what that Messiah would do and who he would be. They began to think in terms of political and military and other sort of manifestations. They lost track of the thing. But there's all these little promises, these little hints, these little instances just saturative in their own scriptures that they had lost track of. We mentioned that in our first presentation where Paul says that my people, the Jewish people, are reading their own book and they're missing the point. There's a veil over their face because that veil is taken away in Messiah. That veil is taken away in Christ. And I want to share with you just one of those promises. It's in Psalm 40. Verse 6, one of those little glimmering promises. Sacrifice and offering you did not desire. My ears you have opened, my Bible says. My ears you have opened. The word is pierced. Hold on to that. You didn't desire sacrifice and offering. You have pierced my ears. Burnt offering and sin offering you did not require. Then I said, watch this, behold, I come in the scroll of the book, in the old books of Moses and others. It is written of me, I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is in my heart. That covenant law, supreme love for God, an authentic love for man. And he says, you don't desire sacrifice and offering. You're not a bloodthirsty God who longs to see virgins thrown into volcanoes. No, you want to pierce our ears? Well, that's not very Adventist. What does that mean? What does that mean? Now, with this, I need you to hear me out on a kind of a weird thing. And Rodley, I need you to come up here. Can you come join me, Rodley? Yeah, come on up, buddy. Just going to move this out. Have a seat.
Sure.
And I need you to imagine, this won't be hard. I need you to imagine that Rodley is an ancient patriarchal figure. Wealthy,
yes. Yes.
Possessing lands and herds, flocks, estates. I mean, look at him.
I like that.
He likes it. Children and children's children and servants. And I mean, he's like an Abrahamic figure, right? You got that picture in your mind? It's not hard to imagine when you see that. Now, I'm going to go to a strange place. It's Exodus 21. And in Exodus 21, the Bible gives this kind of strange little law about how to relate to slaves. Okay, hold on to this. And here's what it says. It says, I'm picking it up in Exodus 21 and verse 1. Now these are the judgments which you shall set before them, Israel. If you buy a Hebrew servant, he shall serve 6 years, and in the seventh he shall go out free and pay nothing. Now this sounds really weird to us, this idea of buying a human. Right? We say, oh, anathema, that's slavery. But that's not. You have to disabuse your mind of any images that you have of like the slave trade here in America. It's not that. This was an economic institution. A what, everyone? An economic institution by which, if I say was in debt to Rodley or to somebody else perhaps, Rodley could help me out, but if I was in debt to Rodley, we'll keep it nice and simple, I could indenture myself to Rodley for a negotiated period of time as a servant because I lacked the necessary liquid resources to just pay him off. And so I could say, you know, Rodley, I owe you X amount of dollars, and we would negotiate, and he would say, okay, you serve me for 5 years. And we would shake on it, and we'd be in. 5 years. So when the 5 years is done, we're going to shake hands again, and I have discharged my debt. Rodley's happy. I'm happy. It's an economic institution, right? Just kind of like a bank. Okay? So far, so good. Now listen, there's some rules associated with this so that we can be sure that it's operating fair and equitably. Verse 3, if he, that's the servant, if he comes in by himself, he will go out by himself. Well, that seems fair, doesn't it? So if I indenture myself to Rodley for a period of 5 years as a single man, and my 5 years is over and I've discharged my debt, how do I leave? I leave as a single man, right? I go in single, I go out single. Okay, now notice the next one here. It says, if he goes in married, his wife will go out with him. Right? Just spelling out the very simple legal parameters of this agreement. In other words, if I go in and I already have a wife, and I serve my 5 years with Rodley, when I go to leave after my debt is paid, Rodley has no legal, contractual, covenantal right to my wife. This was an agreement between us, and so the Bible says, hey, if you go in single, you go out single. But if I go in with a wife, if I go in married, how do I go out? Married, but there's another possible situation, another possible thing that could happen. Verse 4, if his master, that's Rodley, has given him a wife and she has borne him sons or daughters, the wife and her children shall be her master's and he shall go out by himself. Now here's a third situation. Let's say that as I join myself to Rodley, you have a daughter or daughters or you have nieces or whatever it might be, and because you're the patriarch in your family, when I join myself to you as a single man and I fall in love, say, with one of your daughters, and you give me the right to marry her and you give her permission as well, and we're married in that 5-year period, what Scripture says is I don't just automatically have the right to take her at the end of that 5-year period. That would also have to be subsequently negotiated. Now, the reason for that makes pretty good sense. Maybe she operated in some significant office in Rodley's situation. You know, maybe Rodley needs her, and if I run off with her, then he's going to be left high and dry. So that would have to be further negotiated, and we have stories like Laban and Jacob, just like that, okay? So if I go in single, I go out how? But if I go in married, I go out how? Married. But if I go in single and he gives me a wife, right, and I fall in love with somebody in his camp, how do I go out? Single, unless I further negotiate maybe another 2 or 3 years, or I just pay you a dowry or whatever it might be. So far, so good. You understand the point? Now watch this. Verse 5, but if the servant plainly says, now the reason the Bible says here he plainly says it is that what you're about to hear is so astonishing it would have to be plainly said. Right? If the servant plainly says, I love my master, my wife, and my children, look at these next 6 words, I will not go out free. I have learned that Rodley is an honest man, he's a man of integrity, he's a man of enterprise, and he is just exactly the kind of person I want for a boss. And I say, Rodley, I've been working for you for 5 years, I've fallen in love with your daughter, we've already borne you a grandchild, I don't want to go. I want to stay with you, and if it's agreeable to you, and I would plainly say, I want to remain your servant forever because I love my wife, and I love you, I love my wife, and I love my children. And if Rodley is as similarly enthusiastic about me as I am about him, we don't just handshake on this. No. This is way too big. You don't just shake on that one because for all the judges would know, he might be manipulating me or vice versa. And so watch what happens. After I plainly state, I don't want to be free. I will voluntarily surrender my freedom because I love you. Because I what? Love you. Watch what happens. It says in verse 5, but if the servant plainly says, I love my master, my wife, and my children, I will not go out free, then his master, we, will go to the judges. And he will bring him to the door. We will explain this. Hey, we've had this contractual agreement. We explain it to the judge's panel. And then they say, are you sure about this? Yes, I'm sure. I mean, you're voluntarily relinquishing your freedom. You understand what you're doing. Look, I love my master. I love my wife. And I love my children. I don't want to be free. I would rather be with him than be independent. And then they say to Rodley, are you sure you like this guy? You want him? Yes, we plainly communicate it. Then what happens is most interesting. It says that I am brought to the doorpost and my master. Now, let's just understand that. What's the purpose of a door? Yeah, it's to go in or out, just like that right there. Exit sign, right? To go in or out. So I am brought by the judges to the door with my master as a symbol that I'm free to leave. I'm free to go. You sure you want to do this? I love my master. I love my wife. And I love my children. I don't want to be free. Okay. Then my master pierces my ears with an awl. And I am now a forever servant to my master. And that pierced ear is a symbol that I have voluntarily surrendered my freedom for love, because he's the kind of master that it would be, I would be willing to give my freedom over to him for a larger purpose, a purpose of love and a purpose of family. We together? Now unpause. Thanks, Rodley. Unpause. We're landing this plane right now. When Jesus was in Gethsemane, he was standing in the door. When Peter took out his sword and tried to cut off the head of one of the high priests, Jesus says, hey, put that thing away. Don't you know I'm standing in the door? Don't you think I could call my father and right at this moment he would send legions of angels to, I'm free to go. I'm under no obligation to be here. I am free to leave, but I love my master, and I love my family, and I love my children. I will not go free. I will be faithful. And so here's Jesus in Gethsemane, and as the sin of the world is being levied upon him, and Satan is throwing every possible temptation and all of this, you know, hideous, demonic stuff, I mean, torturous stuff, from the tearing out of the beard to the punching in the face to the crown of thorns and ultimately to that grand, torturous device invented by the Carthaginians likely and perfected by the Romans, the instrument of torture, the cross. Jesus is raised up, and Satan now, like a rabid shark in a feeding frenzy, he just piles torture on torture and pain on pain, and he's kind of getting almost titillated by the excitement of it all. And then in that moment when Jesus, he breathes his last breath, Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing, and he dies. Satan says, yes, I got him. Only in the next moment to realize he never broke covenant with God. He never sinned. In winning, I just lost. In the words of Ellen White, he, in his excitement, he bore his chest. Yeah! Only to receive the stroke of death. He pushed, he pushed, he pushed, and Jesus, from the young age, all the way up, faithful to God, faithful to man, faithful to God, faithful to man, faithful to God, faithful to man. And even with all of the leverage of sin, darkness, pain, suffering, death, and disease pressing upon him, and Satan himself leveraging everything that was possible, he was standing in the door. He could have blinked and left. He could have left. He was free to go, free to leave. But he said, I love my master. That's the covenant. I love my master. And I love my wife, the church, and I love my family. I will not go free. I will bind myself to my family. And in that moment, he was faithful unto death. And when Satan thought he had gained the greatest of victories, he actually inflicted himself, loss on himself, and the covenant, the family of God that had been extended to Adam and extended to Noah, and extended to Abraham, and extended to all of the descendants of Abraham, and it was extended to you. It's been extended to you, but you failed, and I failed, and Adam failed, and Noah failed, and Abraham failed. Everybody failed. A failure to keep covenant, a failure to keep covenant, a failure to keep covenant, a failure to keep covenant. So what God does is he outflanks the devil. He goes the long way around. He becomes a man himself. The only way this covenant is ever going to be kept is if I do it myself. And so the family of God is extended, the hand of God is extended, and here comes another hand. There's a hand coming, and it's keeping covenant, and it's faithful unto death, under the most extenuating and terrible and austere and painful and torturous circumstances. This hand, it's a human hand. It's a human hand. It's the hand of Adam. It's the hand of Israel. It's the hand of Jesus. And it lays hold on the hand of God and the family of God, and the family of man is reunited. And you say, "Whoa, that's an amazing story. I love that story. What do I get to do?" You get to believe it. You get to believe it. The story has never been about your faithfulness. It's always been about God's faithfulness. But in a remarkable twist of events, he's been faithful not only as God. He has been faithful as man as well. Faithful as Adam, faithful as Israel, faithful as Jesus. Connected.